Yes, students, as we have already started lesson number 4, traders to ruler, under this chapter we have done that how trading companies from England and trading companies of Portuguese, Dutch and French came here in India to establish their trade relationship. But after some time they started to establish their control over the land portions. And after the Battle of Buxar and Battle of Plassey, as both these battles were won by East India Company, now they were having huge control and huge power in the hands of this East India Company. And after all, they were having the control over the major land portion. Even the Nawab of Awadh, he was totally dependent upon the company, and as a company promised him to pay a pension of rupees 20 lakh a year to the Mughal emperor. It means now everything was under the control of East India Company in many parts of India. So today we will discuss dual government and few other topics. So let us start with the dual government. After the company got the Diwani right in Bengal, Diwani right means the right to collect land revenue. It means when company means East India Company here. So when East India Company got the right to collect land revenue in Bengal, Bihar and Orissa, Lord Clive established a dual system of government there. So Lord Clive, he established dual government, means double type of system in these particular areas, Bengal, Bihar and Orissa. So what was this dual system, dual government? So under it, the same person acted as the deputy Diwan on behalf of the company and the deputy Subedar on behalf of the Nawab. It means one person will be there and he will work as deputy Diwan on behalf of the company and deputy Subedar on behalf of the Nawab. It means for both company as well as Nawab he will work. And something that was not in favor of India, that was English had got the right to nominate the deputy Subedar. So this deputy Diwan or deputy Nawab, those who were working for these both company as well as Nawab, under this system English means the British government and East India Company, they got the right to nominate deputy Subedar. So deputy Subedar that will be nominated by English, it means that deputy Subedar will work according to East India Company only. So as such, the English had the power but no responsibility. So now they are having the powers but they were not having any kind of responsibility. But on the other hand, the Nawab had the responsibility but no power or resources. So all the resources, as it is written here, na, Diwani right, company got, means land revenue will be collected by the company, but company was not having any kind of responsibility. But on the other hand, Nawab was not having any kind of resources to increase income, but he was having responsibility only. So he was powerless but with the responsibilities. Bengal, Bihar and Orissa suffered badly and were drained of their wealth under the dual system. So under this dual system, Bengal, Bihar and Orissa, they suffered because the wealth from these particular area was getting drained to Britain and the Nawab was not at all powerful. Then the method of expansion. So with this Diwani right and with the provision of dual government, day by day company was getting more and more powers. So now they adopted some method to expand their control. So method of expansion, The East India Company transformed itself to a territorial colonial power. So it means now they establish their power here in India and they are having control over the land portions of India. And within 100 years from a commercial trading venture, the company transformed itself into a ruling enterprise. It means earlier they were the traders only, they were the business persons only, they were here to do their business, to do their trade here in India. But later on, within the time period of 100 years, they transformed themselves into a ruling power. It means now they were having the control to rule over India. Then by 1857, the company came to exercise territory. It exercised all the possible methods to expand. So here methods to expand means to expand their control over the land portion of India. So rest of the portion that were not under the control of company till the date, they started to use other methods how to make their control over the land portion of entire India. So those methods are, so from here question could be there, write down the methods adopted by the company to expand their control over the territories. So first method is blame of misadministration. Lord Dalhousie annexed Awadh to the English Empire in 1856 by blaming the misadministration of Nawab Wazir Ali's government. So according to Lord Dalhousie, Nawab Wazir Ali, he was not ruling his area well, means his administration was not up to the mark. The company decided to grant a pension of rupees 12 lakh per year to him. And he was sent to Calcutta, but this annexation created a discontentment among the people against the English rule. So according to Lord Dalhousie, as Nawab was not able to run the administration or run the government well, so company decided to give him yearly pension of 12 lakh. It means he was, means the Nawab was sent to Calcutta and all his powers were taken by the company, and the people were not happy with this. Second method, by conquest. The British fought a number of wars to expand their empire in India. They added the territories to their empire after conquering Indian states. So here blame of mismanagement was there, and in many other parts, those other parts were conquered by the warfares. So the territories that were conquered were, means the territory that were conquered by the wars were Sindh, Punjab, Bengal, Mysore, Hyderabad, and certain portions of Myanmar and Nepal. So these areas were conquered by the Britishers. Third is by subsidiary alliances. So Lord Wellesley adopted the system of subsidiary alliances. Here question could be there, who adopted the system of subsidiary alliances? That was Lord Wellesley. So with the purpose of controlling the native power effectively and organizing a strong English army, it means he started subsidiary alliances to start to make some kind of a friendly relations with the other rulers, with the native powers, so that they can rule over the area properly and to maintain strong English army here in India, and to liquidating the French influence in India, means to stop or to reduce the influence of French people in India, and to build the English company into a strong sovereign power. So finally, to make the East India Company as a sovereign means free from any other control, sovereign power here in India. And the following were the main features of this policy. First feature of this policy is, means this, the subsidiary alliances policy. First is, any Indian ruler who entered into the subsidiary alliance with the English would give money or some territory for the maintenance of British contingent in their territory. So British contingent means the large land masses. So here in India, Britishers established their colonies. They were having their own armies. And according to the subsidiary alliances, any Indian ruler who entered in the subsidiary alliances, so subsidiary alliances in means a kind of business partners. So the rulers who became a kind of business partners with this East India Company, they had to pay money and some territory also. For what purpose? For the maintenance of that land portion that was under the control of Britishers, as well as for the army of the Britishers, means to pay the expenses of their army. Second point is, such rulers would neither enter into any alliance with any other power, nor would declare war without the permission of the English. It means now the rulers, those who were in this alliance, they will, means they were not able to make any other alliances. It means they were not able to establish any other type of relations or business relationship with any other, and even they were not able to declare war without the permission. And they would keep a British resident at their respective capital. So where their capital was, there they had, means they, means the rulers of India, those who were under this alliance, they had to keep British resident. It means a political agent that will be the agent of the company or British during that time in the capital. And they would not employ any non-English European, and if they were any already, they would dismiss them. So if already some other rather than the English person is appointed, they will, means those rulers will dismiss that person, and they will not appoint any other person except English persons. And in return for accepting these conditions, the company undertook the product such princes from internal disorders and external dangers. So those who will enter this in the subsidiary alliances, they will provide all these kind of things to the Britishers. In return, Britisher will take care of their territories from the enemies. It means they will protect them. They will protect them. They will protect their territories from internal as well as from external dangers and disorders, if any type of disorder is there. Means disorder was there during that time. And the Nizam of Hyderabad was the first to enter into this alliance. So who was the first person who entered in this subsidiary alliance? He was the Nizam of Hyderabad. And Tipu Sultan of Mysore refused to accept it. But after the British voice victory in the fourth Anglo-Mysore war, Mysore was forced to become a subsidiary ally. So Tipu Sultan, he was not ready to accept this alliance, but after the Anglo-Mysore war that was won by the British East India Company, now Mysore was forcefully become subsidiary alliance. And later the Maratha ruler Bajirao II also accepted subsidiary alliances in the territory of Basin. So this area also now kind of subsidiary alliance. Then fourth one is, by doctrine of Labs? And this is very important question could be there. What was doctrine of Labs, or by whom this doctrine of Labs was introduced? So doctrine of Labs was introduced by Lord Dalhousie. Under this system, if an Indian ruler, means what was this doctrine of Labs? So the answer is, if an Indian ruler did not have his own real son, he could not adopt the son of his relative without the sanction of the Governor General. So if any Indian ruler is not having his own real son, and if he wanted to adopt from his relative, so he was not able to adopt without the permission of Governor General. And the other thing was, they were not able to get permission, as Britishers were not ready to give this permission. And thus the Indian rulers of such states where the rulers are not having their own real sons, those states became helpless before the company. And under this doctrine of Labs, the provision was that after the death of the ruler, those who were not having their own sons, their kingdom used to be annexed to the English territories. So their kingdoms automatically will entered in the English territories. And as the permission to adopt a heir had been refused by the Governor General, as I told you, they were not ready to give permission to adopt a son. So in this way, the company annexed Sitara, Nagpur, Jhansi, Jaipur, Udaipur, Sambhal and Bhagaut. So under this under this doctrine of Labs, those rulers, those who were not having their own real sons, their territories were annexed by the East India Company. So another question from here could be there, write down the name of states which were captured by the British East India Company under doctrine of Labs. Then your answer will be Sitara, Nagpur, Jhansi, Jaipur, Udaipur. Means from here you can write down those names. So with this, our chapter is over here. And if you are having any doubt, you can message me. Next time, I will send you question answer and exercise of this chapter. So till the time, watch this video, try to get the meaning of all the topics. Thank you.